Yes, sir.
Yeah, yeah. It's the first time I'm taking a class online. So I guess you would have attended a few online classes earlier, right? So that way you are more experienced than I am. So let us see how it goes. Today is the first class, and you know, I have been assigned the course MAG5, which is literary criticism and theory, which is literary criticism and theory. Now, how many of you can we make it an interactive class, sir, or is it like a one-way lecture?
It's up to you, sir. It's up to you. You can make also interactive classes.
Okay. So now let us look at literary criticism and theory. I assume all of you have read the blocks. Have you gone through the study material which IGNU has given you? At least some part of it. Anyone? अपन माने के टिके भी पढ़ी चुनती जो मटेरियल टा अपन मानों को दिया है ची कुछ पढ़ी चुनती अपनो ठीक अच्छे ओके सो लेट अस लुक एट द बेसिक्स टुडे लिटरेरी क्रिटिसिज्म एंड थियरी ओके नाउ यू नो वन ऑफ द मेनी प्रॉब्लम्स दैट आर एसोसिएटेड with the study of literature, okay? Problems in the sense, you know, an issue rather. Let me rephrase it. Some of the issues facing the study of literature today, you know, go down to the very basics. So say, for example, in the 20th century, you know, very term literature became a problem. The very term literature became a problem. So what is literature? You know, what do we understand by literature? Anyone? What do we understand by literature? Literature is the study of... What do we commonly understand? You know, when I say, okay, you are students of English literature. So what do you understand by the term English literature? We understand the term to mean short stories, novels, drama, poetry, essays, literary essays. Okay, so all of these come under the ambit of literature. Am I right? Is it clear to you or not? Is it clear to you? Can you hear me, all of you? Please raise your hand or say yes if you can hear me.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So this is what we commonly understand when we say literature. But then nowadays, in the 20th century, actually it all began with Terry Eagleton. Okay. So Terry Eagleton was a very famous Marxist critic. He was a very famous Marxist critic, and you know, he said, you know, it's a very elitist definition. You know, the definitions that we have of literature are very elitist. You know, why? Say, for example, I'll just give you you know, an example so that the whole thing becomes clear to you. There is writing which is of a high literary quality but doesn't qualify as English literature. For example, an article in a newspaper. It can be very literary, but does it count as literature? You know, probably no. Okay. Or for example, in literature, there might be passages or parts of literature which do not have a very high literary quality. So it becomes a problem. You know, how are we to define what literature is? And the definition itself is problematic. Now, I want all of us to remember one thing. I want all of us to remember one thing, which is that, you know, these are not issues or problems which have very easy answers. These are not issues or problems which have very easy answers. But then what we have to do is, we have this in mind when we are doing literary criticism and theory. We have to keep these issues and problems in mind when we study MEG 5, literary criticism and theory. Okay. Now, what is the meaning? See, literature itself is a problem. So now we have seen that literature itself is a problem. The term itself, come back to another point. What are the many meanings in which the word literature is used? Let us say, when you buy a bottle of medicine, a cough syrup, when you buy cough syrup, with that you also get some writing. You also get some printed material with that. Okay? When you buy any product, you get some printed material with that. So we call it the literature of that product. We call it the literature of that product. So there can be medical literature, there can be legal literature, there can be literature about a product, there can be literature about a travel service organization. Okay, so but we have to remember that we use the word literature in a very specific sense. We use it to refer to, you know, works of fiction, poetry, drama, you know, all of this we use them to understand literature. Okay. Now, literary criticism and theory. Now, what is the meaning of literary criticism? What is the meaning of literary criticism? See, criticism basically is the very act of reading literature. Or I'll give you an example. You know, all of us watch movies. So when we watch movies, what happens? You watch the movie, and after you finish watching the movie, you can you compare notes with your friends. If it's a good movie, you say, yeah, I like the movie. You say why you like the movie. Say, for example, you thought that a particular actor performed the role very powerfully, or the songs were good, or the dialogue, the screenplay was very good. Okay, so you start discussing with your friends and family members, you know, what it is about the film that you liked or did not like. So in a very basic sense, you are interpreting. In a very basic sense, you are interpreting. Now, when we do literary criticism, what are we doing? Now, we are interpreting a text. We are interpreting a text, whether it's a poem, a short story, an essay, we are interpreting it. But we try to interpret it more as a specialist. You know, it's not. One critic said that the very act of reading itself is interpretation. Okay, I'll give you an example. All of us watch a movie. It's not necessary that all of us respond to the movie in the same way. Okay. Some of you might respond favorably to the movie. some of you might respond unfavorably to the movie because it resonates with you in a way that you don't like, or that reminds you of something unpleasant about your own life or something about your community. Okay, say for example, you know, the depiction of India in a movie or Indians in a particular movie, they are shown as being subservient to the Britishers. The Britisher may like the movie, but we watching it as Indians may not like it. Okay, I'll just stray a little. See, today, in today's class, you know, I'll try to be as general as possible. You know, because you know, it's the first time, you know, I'm getting used to this whole thing. And theory, the paper also, the paper which I'm going to, which I'm dealing with, it's very dense. It's very dense in the sense, lot of ideas are there. There are a lot of ideas, and it's very difficult to understand these ideas. Not difficult, unfamiliar. It's very unfamiliar. Most of these ideas are unfamiliar. So what I'll do today is, you know, I'll try to, you know, kind of lay the groundwork, you know, for us to really understand what is there in the rest of the course. What is there in the rest of the course? So, to come back to the example I was giving you, that, you know, we don't respond to a film or a book the same way. Let us say there are some women in the class, some girls are there. You know, as a man, I might react differently to a movie. As a woman, you might react differently to a movie or respond differently to a movie or a novel. Do you understand what I'm trying to say? So, you know, interpretation becomes subjective. Interpretation becomes subjective. Now, what is the meaning of subjective? Subjective is where your, you know, ideas, your thoughts, your feelings, your perceptions, they matter more than anything else. They influence the way you understand something, you read something, you perceive something. Okay, so interpretation becomes a subjective activity. Interpretation becomes a subjective activity. So literary criticism, you can think of literary criticism as interpretation of literature, reading of literature, understanding of literature in a way that technical or experts in the field would do. You understand? Say, for example, if at all you are reading a novel, you are reading a poem, let us say. You are reading a poem. So when we are reading a poem, what happens? You look at the poem in terms of the diction, okay? The words that are used in the poem. You look at the syntax, the way in which words are arranged in the poem. You look at the literary devices, simile, metaphor, synecdoche, metonymy, all of these devices, how the poet has used these for effect in the poem. You look at connotation and denotation. What is connotation? What is denotation? Connotation, denotation is basically the, denotation is the literary meaning of the word. Now say, if I say rose, for example, now what's a rose? At the literal A rose is a flower. But what are the extended meanings of the word rose? When I say rose, what are the ideas which come to your mind? Love, beauty, passion. All of these are ideas which come to your mind when I say the word rose. That is connotation, the connotative meaning. So one is the literal meaning and the other one is the connotative meaning. Now, what am I trying to do here? Now, why am I telling you all of this? I am telling you all of this to give you an idea of what literary criticism is. That you have to read literature as a specialist does. You have to read literature as a specialist does. And for that, you have to be aware of these aspects of literary criticism. Okay. Now, there are a lot of ideas. I told you this entire paper is full of ideas. This entire paper is full of ideas. You have a lot of ideas. Okay. One thing all of us, we have to keep in mind, I include myself here, is that nobody can understand everything that is there to know about theory. None of us, very few of us can say, I understand theory completely. As beginners, what we can do is, we can see whatever little you understand, use that as a stepping stone for knowing more. Because when somebody comes to theory for the first time, the first impulse is to leave it and run away. Array, what is the use of reading all this? I can't, it's very difficult. But then slowly when you start reading it, when you start, you know, dealing with it, you know, listening to people, talking to people, you realize that it's not so difficult after all. I'll tell you how theory works, how I make sense of theory. You know, it's very important to personalize your learning experience. We have to personalize our learning experience. So, you know, let us take the case of Isaac Newton. What did he do? He was sitting under a tree and then the apple fell. And then he asked a very simple question, you know, why did the apple fall? Why did it not rise? Why did the apple fall? Why did it not rise? You know, trillions of apples must have fallen since the beginning of time. Okay. So all of us, people took it to be a natural phenomenon. Yeah, things fall. Things don't go up normally, unless you throw it or a bird flies upward. But then he questioned, what is it? And then, you know, he discovered the laws of gravitation. Okay. Think of a religion. So Newton observed, right? He observed and then he made a hypothesis, he tested the hypothesis, and then he theorized. And then we have the laws of gravitation, the theory of gravitation. Now think of the religions. You know, all of us, the pandemic has taught us that, you know, the basic humanity. First of all, we are human, which we should have remembered always, but this has brought home the reality of our basic humanity. Now, we live in this world. There is the sun and there is the moon and there are the stars and there are the oceans and all of that. Now, we have different religions. Okay. So the dominant religion in India, for example, Hinduism. Hinduism developed a certain view of the world. You know, how there was creation, who are the three major gods, why is there an eclipse? So, why do we fall ill? How to drive away evil spirits? Okay, what happens when we die? So all of these issues are addressed in a certain way by the Hindu religion. Okay, what do we say that, okay, we are born, we die, and then depending on our actions, we are reborn, you know, either as humans or maybe as lower order animals. Christianity has its own worldview. You die, you're born, you die, and then you go to heaven or hell, depending on what you have done in this world. The souls, there is a judgment day at the end of the world. So what am I saying? What is it I'm trying to say? That these are all theories which try to explain the world to us. You can think of Hinduism as a grand narrative, a theory which encompasses everything, starting from you know, wedding to deaths to births to agriculture to you know, a scientific phenomenon. It explains everything: religion, soul, death, birth, everything is explained. Similarly, Christianity, Islam, you know, Judaism, the Jewish religion, all of the religions, they theorize about the world. Do you understand now how it is subjective? It becomes subjective for groups of people. Okay. You know, religions, so millions and millions of people, we believe in a particular religion. So what am I trying to do in this class? I am trying to give you a sense of what is literature, point number one. What is literary criticism? And what is theory? From there, we'll go to a literature specific study. From there, we'll go to a literature specific study. What exactly it means for us in literature. Okay. So literary theory also, you know, it seeks to theorize about literature. Okay. What is literature? Who is a poet? What is a poet? What is a text? Who is a reader? What is meaning? Who makes meaning? So all these are issues that we will deal with theory. Okay. Now, one thing all of us have to keep in mind. One thing which all of us have to keep in mind is that there is a difference between literary criticism and theory. There is a big difference between literary criticism and theory. There is a book. The book is written by Peter Barry. Peter Barry, Beginning Theory. Beginning Theory. Now, the very first chapter of that book tells you what it is about. The very first chapter tells you what are the differences between literary theory and literary criticism. Okay. If you ask me What is one major difference between literary criticism and theory? Literary criticism and theory. The answer would be, theory is about power. Literature is supposedly apolitical. Apolitical means nothing to do with politics. That is what they like to say. What is theory? On the other hand, they believe in relationship. They believe in power. One word you have to remember, that is power. That word is power. Now, power, you have to understand power in a very broad sense. You have to understand power in a very broad sense, not in the sense of a particular political party coming to power. A so-and-so party is there in power at the center, or so-and-so party is in power at, in the state. But that is not the definition of power that we are discussing here. This is the kind of power which large groups of people exercise over other groups of people. This is the power which large groups of people exercise over other groups of people. So, what would some examples be? Men exercising power over women. Okay. Patriarchy. We live in a patriarchal society where men as a group have more power than women. In India, we have the caste system. Certain castes are more powerful than others. Some castes are perceived to be powerful, upper castes. That's a relationship of power. In the West, in England, say, for example, you have a class-based society. The aristocracy, the middle classes, the working classes. So there also there is a relationship of power. Who has the power? The upper classes, the middle classes, or think of white and black, or white and non-white. Countries which are inhabited by white people are more powerful than countries which are inhabited by non-whites. So, I hope I've given you some idea of what I mean by power. I've given you some idea of what I mean by power. In theory, now, theory takes into account relationships of power while interpreting a work of art. Theory takes into account a relationship of power while looking at a work of art. Okay. Now, see, all of you please keep in mind one thing that, I'm throwing many ideas today. If you are not familiar with some of these terms, don't worry. You can look them up in your study material or elsewhere. Okay. And these are terms which will occur frequently when you are studying literature. Okay. So now let us look at the I'm just trying to tell you how theory is different from criticism. How theory is different from criticism I told you the fundamental point is theory talks about relationships of power and brings this knowledge to bear while reading a literary text. But literary criticism says that, you know, we are apolitical. Literature is apolitical. Okay. Now, the point I was coming back to, what was the point I was trying to make about power? Yeah. So theory is about relationships of power. Yeah, canon. Yeah. The point I wanted to make was in talking about theory, I wanted to talk about canon. C-A-N-O-N, canon. Literary canon. Okay. The term is literary canon. C-A-N-O-N. When we read, see, 20, 30, 40 years ago, when we were studying literature, we were studying the works of, even today, if you see, the major emphasis when we are studying literature is on who are the writers who come to mind when we say literature? Shakespeare, Keats, Wordsworth, Byron, Milton, Matthew Arnold, T.S. Eliot, Robert Browning, Tennyson. These are the names which come to mind. Most of these men, most of these writers, they are male men. They belong to the upper classes. They belong to the upper classes. Now the question is, were women not writing? Were people of the working classes not writing? Why are their texts not studied? Till 30, 40, 50 years ago, they were not studied. Or take the example of American literature. Till 30, 40, 50 years ago, Black American writers were not studied. Native American writers were not read. Only white male authors were read. So do you see now how theory works, how politics works? What is the politics here? That even there are women writers, there are Black writers, but their works are not considered sufficiently important to be read as literature. I hope I am making myself clear to all of you. So, literary theory, for example, would ask a question, why is it that only certain books are included in the canon and not books by women writers, Black women writers, gay writers, lesbian writers? Why are they not being studied? So now you understand politics. Now you understand politics. You know, I'll give you another example, the favorite example. While teaching theory, you know how the whole thing works. See, I think after about 5 or 10 minutes, I'll take a break. We can take a break. And the next half an hour, I'll spend on the text. You know, what is there in the study material? And then maybe I can address a few of your questions at the end. Okay. The example which I'm going to give you now, in order to help you understand, you know, this politics of power. Okay, but before that, let me complete know, the difference I was telling you between literary criticism and theory. Literary criticism would be, say, for example, I don't know if you have heard of it, there is a school of criticism called New Criticism. New Criticism. New Criticism would say that there is no politics in the text, there is no politics in the study of literature, all the meaning is there in the poem itself, all the meaning is there in the work of art itself. Please remember one thing. Many critics and theorists, they talk about poetry, but what they say applies to all of literature. But they choose to talk about poetry because a poem is relatively small. The language is relatively dense. So when somebody is making an observation on poetry, we can assume that it is, you know, it applies to the study of other forms also, other literary forms also. Okay. So, literary criticism would say there is no politics in the text, but theory would say there is politics in everything. There is politics in everything. Okay. Why, for example, should texts written only by white male authors be studied and not works, let us say, written by Indian authors, Indian women writers, Indian lesbian writers, Indian gay writers? Why should we not study all of that? So nowadays you find that more and more literary texts which are written by people belonging to marginalized sections of the society. Someone could be a transgender, someone could be a bonded laborer. Okay, so their accounts, somebody could be from one of the many oppressed classes of society, so their writings are gaining prominence. Their writings are gaining prominence. Why? Because in order that literature should be comprehensive, there should be representation of writings from all sections of society. From all sections of society. Okay. So what I'll do now is I'll quickly run you through the material. The first one is, what is literature criticism and theory? You know, in this unit, all that I've discussed so far, you can see the components. What is literature? What is literary criticism? What is theory? Contradistinction. Background to the contemporary situation in theory. The contemporary situation in theory is the result of many influential thinkers, most influential being Marxism. Marxist thought has influenced all fields of study, and literary criticism is no exception. So, Marxism, then you have studies on race. RACE, race, you have studies on gender, you have studies on psychoanalysis. All of these have influenced, you have, biological theories also. You know, how all of them say that there is a biological basis for evolution, not a theological basis. So all of these influence, writing, literary criticism, theory, all of them influence because we realize that we are living in a godless universe. There is no God. So that is how you have to make sense of the world. So that is why theory also changes. But the point is, background to the contemporary situation in theory. the contemporary situation, as I told you, nowadays you have a lot of new theories. You have say, for example, LGBT theories, Marxist theories, post-colonial theories, eco-criticism, peer studies, lot of theories are there. So what is the background to all these theories? Then 1.5 talks of from criticism to theory. So what is criticism? What is theory? And how there was a transition from criticism to theory? And then the communication chain. Okay. So let us look at the summing up, and then I'll tell you how what I said feeds into what is there in the book also. I have in this unit tried to analyze the subtle and not so subtle distinctions between literature and criticism, as well as literary criticism and theory. We saw that theory, that is the impulse towards thinking about the act of literary criticism or judgment, was always there. So all of us have, the ability to theorize. There was a time when some critics acted as if they did not use any theory. You know, the new critics, for example, they said, there is no meaning outside the text, no theory, we don't use any theory. But then the theorists disproved that. They showed them that they also are political, they also use theory. That liberal humanism, which is often foisted as an alternative to theory, is itself a theory. Thank you. Okay, now before theory, whatever criticism was there in literature, in literary studies, that came under, broadly it was called liberal humanism. What is liberal humanism? That, humanism where you say man is at the center of the universe. So whatever you do, you have to think of how it affects man. So all the literary criticism comes under the umbrella term liberal humanism. The one I told you, it says we are not political, there is no meaning outside the text, we are not concerned with politics of any kind. But nowadays, the theorists point out that liberal humanism itself is also a kind of theory. I have further tried to trace in this unit a brief history of how criticism has given way to theory in the 20th century, and particularly isolated those non-literary considerations, ideologies, which went into the making of pre-theory criticism. Okay, so how theory came about, the background to theory. The first unit. Okay, I'll end the first unit with one more observation, which is when I was studying theory, the teacher asked us, did you ever theorize? Did you ever theorize? Forget literature, forget everything. Did you ever theorize? Now, I remembered a particular instance from my childhood. I was in school then. I'm giving you my example because I know myself more about myself than about anyone else. And it also tells you how you can relate to theory at a personal level, at least at the beginning stage. So when I was in school, I thought that everybody in this world is related. Everybody in this world is related. Now, in my fanciful mind, how did I prove that this idea that two people marry? All the relatives of X become relatives of Y, however distant. You understand? Now, one of the relatives of X or Y marries, let us say, somebody in some other part of the world or other part of the country. So they also become relatives, X, Y, Z. So now Z also becomes a relative of X through Y. So I thought in this way, everybody in the world is connected. So that's it. I mean, like childhood things, you know how they are. You think about it and then you don't pay much attention to it. Many years later, I saw there was a book. The name of the book was 7 Degrees of Separation. 6 Degrees of Separation. 6 Degrees of Separation. Now, what was it about? The author says that everybody in the world is related through a chain of intermediaries of not more than 6 persons, which means I can say I am related to, you know, Donald Trump. I can say I'm related to Donald Trump through a series of 6 intermediaries. 6 intermediaries means, you know, I know someone, someone knows someone knows someone else. And in this way, I'm also, you know, I also know Donald Trump. So 6 degrees of separation, that was a book. That was a theory developed by the author. His name was Kuhn, I forget the name. So what I'm trying to say is all of us theorize. All of us have the ability to theorize. Okay, so, you know, we look at people, we look at phenomenon. Let us say some of you, you know, work in a place which is not your own native place. Okay, and then, you know, you see the world in a new way. People see you in a different way. You see people in a different way. Okay, so all of this knowledge, you know, we are theorizing all the time. We are theorizing all the time. That is the point I'm trying to make in Unit 1. Is Patel sir here online? Can Patel sir hear me? Patel sir? I was wondering if at all we can take a break of about 5 or 10 minutes. Can we? Is it allowed? Can we take a break? I don't know how it is done. Okay. Now let us go to unit 2. Now I'll read out the introduction overview of Western critical thought. So what's an overview? Yeah, I'll read out from the now Western critical thought. See, what I'm teaching you for today's class includes some of the points which are there in your book. This is block one. includes some of the points from the book and a lot from my experience of teaching. Okay. From the next class onwards, I'll try to make it more and more specific to the reading material. Okay. Now, I'm sure you are aware, this is from the introduction of Unit 2, Overview of Western Critical Thought. I'm sure you are aware of the commonplace statement that criticism is as old as creation. Criticism is as old as creation. From the moment we are born, we start theorizing, criticizing. What is the meaning of criticize? Criticize. The first meaning of criticize is to talk negatively of someone. Okay, fault finding. One meaning of criticize is fault finding. But we use criticize in a different sense. We use criticize in the meaning or in the sense of evaluate. Criticize in the meaning in the sense of evaluate. What is the meaning of evaluate? Evaluate means to look at the positive aspects, look at the negative aspects, and arrive at some kind of a judgment. Evaluation. So what is the sense in which we use the word, you know, criticism? We use it in the sense of evaluation. Okay. I am sure you are aware of the commonplace statement that criticism is as old as creation. William Wimsett and Cleanth Brooks have said, because poets have a strong tendency to form opinions about their craft and to use these opinions as part of the message of their poems, we are likely to find literary theory of a sort as far back as we can find poems. Okay? Because, you know, we have a certain way of looking at the world. We have a certain way of looking at the world. Whether we like it or not, whether we like it or not, that is reflected in our writing also. That is reflected in our writing also. So, what is Unit 2 saying? That so long as there was poetry, that long we also have criticism. Now this is a very important point. Why is it very important? Because you see, creative writing and criticism are not separate. They become one and the same. You find aspects of criticism in creative writing also. You find aspects of criticism in creative writing also. We are concerned here mostly with Western critical thought. Critical thought derives from general aesthetics, which in turn is guided by philosophical debates and ideas about what reality is, God, and the possibility of absolute knowledge. So here, what is he saying? Critical thought derives from aesthetics. Now, what is the meaning of aesthetics? Aesthetics means theory concerning aspects of beauty. We say something is aesthetic, the interior decoration aesthetic. which means the interior decoration is very pleasing. So critical thought is derived from notions of beauty, and notions of beauty are guided by philosophical debates. So you see, all these things are related. Criticism, theory on beauty, philosophical debates, ultimate reality, whether you call it God or anything else by any other name. So all of these are related. Much of Western critical thought, literary thought, is influenced by Greek and Roman mythology, Greek philosophy, Christianity. All of these traditions have influenced their philosophy, their aesthetic tradition, their concept of what art is or art should be, what criticism is or should be. I'll read it out once again. This is Unit 2, Introduction. We are concerned here mostly with Western critical thought. Critical thought derives from general aesthetics, which is guided by philosophical debates and ideas about what reality is, God, and the possibility of absolute knowledge. Is there any knowledge which can be absolute? Okay. In fact, there has always been a connection between philosophical thought and critical thought. So philosophy is about your questions about life in general, about the world in general, and it always influences other fields of study. There has also been a correspondence between the pagan and Christian concept of the word and logos. The pagan and Christian concept. Now, what is pagan? P-A-G-A-N, pagan. Christianity is a relatively new religion. It began, let us say, 2000 years ago. But there were human beings before that in Europe. They followed a religion, or they had their own religions, which involved a lot of nature worship, worship of natural forces. That was collectively called pagan, P-A-G-A-N, pagan. Nowadays, the word is used in a very negative sense. But as students of literature and criticism, we should remember that, or we should remember to use it in a value neutral term, neutral way. Nothing is good or nothing is bad. Okay, so we are not here to make judgments of that kind. In the beginning was the word, and the word was with God. There has been a correspondence between word, world. A correspondence between W-O-R-D and W-O-R-L-D, world. Just as philosophers have tried to interpret the word and or the world to us, aesthetic inquiry has focused on the literary word. Okay? So I'll just give you an example of what this word and world is about. Word and world. In the 20th century, philosophers tell us that the world is impossible without the word. What does it mean? only when something has a, only when we name something, that is when it comes into existence for us. It's a little dense, it's a little difficult, complex to understand. Don't bother if it, but what we have to keep in mind is we make sense of the world through words. We make sense of the world through words. Okay. Language is the medium through which we name the world, through which we make sense of the world. Okay. So that's very interesting because the idea is, if you want to create a new world, all you have to do is first visualize that world in words, and then the real world also will come about. I'll just give you a small example and leave and proceed from there and go to the next topic, which is like, you know, look at the fact that nowadays so many girls come to college, so many women attend classes. 100 years ago, do you think that was common? But then some thinkers, philosophers, they visualized a new world. They imagined a new world in which women also go to school. Women also are educated. And they wrote about it. And then now you find that women also are getting educated. So the idea is that if at all you want to create a new world, you can begin by imagining it in language. Now, Western, the English literature is not Indian. It is from England, right? And England is in Europe. And they are heavily influenced by, I told you, Greek and the Greek philosophical tradition, by Christianity, by the pagan religions. So whichever subject we study, you find that the origin always goes back to Plato and Aristotle. Plato and Aristotle. Okay, so here also, you know, in literary theory and criticism, we begin with Plato and Aristotle. Okay. One thing about Plato, he wrote a book called Republic. He wrote a book called Republic. And one of the things he talked about in Republic was the world of the ideal world. The ideal world. Okay. So let us say, he says that this world, the world in which we live, is only a representation of the ideal world. This world is a representation of an ideal world, which is somewhere out there. You call it heaven or you call it, you know, philosophy, whatever. But there is an ideal world, and this world is an imperfect realization of that world. Now, why is this statement important to us? This statement is important to us because Plato was talking about a very ideal place, Republic. He said poets don't have a place in the Republic. Poets should be banished from the Republic. Why? Why should poets be banished from the Republic? Because poets are liars. How do poets lie? poets lie because their creation is twice removed from reality. Their creation is twice removed from reality. How? Let us say a poet is writing about a beautiful flower. Now the beautiful flower itself is an imitation of an ideal flower. The ideal flower, where is it? It's in the world of ideals, ideas. So the poet is writing about the flower, which is an imitation of the ideal flower. So it is twice removed from reality. According to Plato, the only real thing is the world of the ideals. Do you understand? So, he doesn't really approve of poets. But then there is a lot more ideas are given in the book. Now, Aristotle, the second major theorist is Aristotle. Aristotle wrote about tragedy. And while writing about tragedy, he also told us about the three classical unities. What he defined for us, what is tragedy, who is a tragic character, what is the tragic flaw, why is there, the downfall of the hero or the central character or the protagonist. Okay, what are the elements of a tragedy? So Aristotle theorized about all of these, okay, in his in his writings. He wrote Poetics. So I'll just read out briefly from the book what he said, what the book says here. Aristotle set a long tradition by applying the techniques of natural science to art and establishing a taxonomy of artistic forms. The taxonomy is what? Classification of life. Similarly, he attempted a classification of art also. He describes tragedy in terms of its four causes. Its material cause is, in the grossest sense, words and gestures, though these can be broken down into plot, character, thought, diction, spectacle, and song. So he breaks down the components of tragedy for us. So that is the most important contribution. And then in the English tradition, so Aristotle and Plato, they were all Greeks. Now in English literature, you have Sir Philip Sidney. And his classic work is Apology for Poetry. Apology for Poetry. Then you have the Romantic tradition. In the Romantic tradition, who do you have? Wordsworth and Coleridge. All of you must be aware of the book written, what is it that they wrote, Wordsworth and Coleridge? They wrote the preface to the Lyrical Ballads. What did they write? They wrote preface to the Lyrical Ballads. Now, what is there in the preface to the Lyrical Ballads? In the preface to the Lyrical Ballads, the nature of poetry, the nature of emotion, what is fancy, what is imagination, how all of these come into play while writing a work of art. So all of that, I'll just read out very briefly. For Wordsworth and Coleridge, this meant a turn away from elevated language and subject matter, a turning towards spontaneity and emotion. So before Wordsworth and Coleridge, the language that was used was a very very flowery. It was not the language of the common people. So one of the greatest contributions of Coleridge and Wordsworth is they said that poetry should be in the language of the common people and not in some great tradition of the past. So you can see that it was a very democratic impulse. You must remember that when Coleridge and Wordsworth were writing, two major events happened. The American War of Independence in 1776, and a few years later, the French Revolution. And what was the buzzword of the French Revolution? Liberty, equality, fraternity. Everyone is equal. So Wordsworth and Coleridge were influenced by these ideals. So they tried to democratize the study of literature, the writing of poetry. Okay. Now, the remaining ones, I'll just sum up, and then I would like to take a break for about 5 or 10 minutes, and then you know we can take some questions. Now, the third unit, I'll read out. I have also tried to simplify some of the key formulation from the modernists down to the postmodernists and post-structuralists. You must have noticed how what had once appeared to be modern or revolutionary concepts of Hulme, Eliot, Pound, Richards have later been shown up as reactionary or hegemonic formulations. Also, we have seen how from the earlier stages of language or text-oriented criticism, latter-day criticism and theory have either, like some structuralists and Derrida, become radically text-centered or contextual. Okay, I'll just explain the main points of the third unit. It is about the developments of theory in the 20th century. Okay. Now, what once appeared to be revolutionary later appeared to be reactionary. What is the meaning of revolutionary? What is the meaning of reactionary? Revolutionary means something which is progressive. Reactionary means something which is more conservative, orthodox, traditional. Okay. So there is an assessment or a re-evaluation of literary theory, criticism, works of literature, everything. At one point of time, probably Shakespeare was not read very widely. But later on, people started reading Shakespeare a lot. The metaphysical poets were not read widely. They were forgotten. Then Samuel Johnson came and revived interest in them. So also, literary theory, critical theory, they are frequently assessed and reassessed. So what previously appeared to be progressive on closer examination turns out to be regressive, traditional or conservative. Okay, have been shown up as reactionary or hegemonic formulations. Hegemonic means having to do with hegemony. Hegemony, it's a term used by an Italian Marxist theorist, Gramsci. So hegemony means power, having to do with relationships of power. Okay. Also, we have seen how from the earlier stages of language or text-oriented criticism, later-day criticism and theory have become radically text-centered or contextualized. Okay. So, earlier, criticism was text-oriented. What is the meaning of text-oriented? the theorists, they said, meaning is to be found only in the text. Meaning is to be found only in the text, which means if you have to understand, interpret, or criticize a work of literature, you don't have to look outside the text. All the meaning is there in the text. But nowadays, we say that kind of reading is not possible. It has to be radically text-centered or contextual. Contextual means what? You have to know the philosophy of the writer, the worldview of the writer, the context in which a particular writer was writing. All of that has to be taken into account when you are interpreting a text. All of that has to be taken into account when you are interpreting a text. Okay. Now, I'll move on to the fourth unit. Okay. I have laid out for your guidance a brief and simplified summary of how various critics in the past have viewed their task as critics. They have usually perceived their task to be an idealistic one. Criticism for such critics serves a social and cultural function. For critics like Coleridge and others with a philosophically inclined mind, took criticism as a way of understanding the difference between the poet's mind and that of the non-poet. Okay. Yet others thought of criticism as a way of improving poetry. Eliot described the critic's task as being directed towards the audience, the elucidation of works of art, and the correction of taste. So I'll just read it out once again. That one is, one function of criticism is to understand how the mind of a poet works in comparison to the mind of a person who is not a poet, a layman. Point number one. Second is criticism as a way to improve poetry, which means you are serving as a guide. The critic is serving as a guide. You are telling the poet how to improve. And the third one is audience oriented or the reader oriented. What is the meaning of that? An interpreter of the work of art to the audience. When we read a newspaper, you find book reviews and cinema reviews. What do you find in a book review? You find a new book is out in the market, whether it is fiction or non-fiction or poetry or whatever. And the critic reads the book for us, looks at the positive points and the negative points, and then gives us some kind of an evaluation. So the critic is serving as a link or a bridge between the work of art and the reader. So what are the three functions of the critic, as you find in chapter 4, unit 4? One is to find out the difference between the mind of a poet and a non-poet. Second is to help poets improve their writing. Third, to interpret a work of art and correct the taste of the reader or the audience. Okay. Now, the last one, I think we are running short of time. I'll quickly sum up what is there in chapter unit 5, which is about Indian aesthetics. We still have one more unit here, chapter 6 or unit 6. You know, okay, let me read out. This is from page number 50. You have material with you, read out, you can read it. Indian literature traditionally, like all other ancient literatures, has been oral. The traditional Indian literature is oral. There is a term that we have for it now. It is orature. It's a combination of two words, oral and literature, orature. In this context of orality, literature has been an act of public communication, the act of communicating to the public. Even non-Hindu and non-native literatures have been performative. You perform these forms. Mushaira, for example. These are performances of sorts. All literature is classified as oral, A-U-R-L. Oral is something that we hear, or visual, or oral visual. Means we hear it, we see it, or we both see and hear it at the same time. Oral, A-U-R-L, not oral. Oral means speaking, A-U-R-L, oral means listening. This fact of oral folk literature practices determines the nature of compositions, the relationship of the literary compositions to the audience slash viewer slash reader, and therefore the concepts of literary theory. In this context, the word literature itself is only partly appropriate. Okay, and then there is the rasa theory in you know, traditional Indian literature. You can read it, and then if at all you have any rasa, three things you have to remember, two things, rasa theory and dhvani theory. So please pay attention to these two in the fifth chapter. And then the last one, I think it's about the resistance to theory. You know, theory received resistance. And then, yeah, that not everyone took to theory kindly. Many people resisted the study of theory. I'll just take a break for 2 or 3 minutes. I'll be back in 2 or 3 minutes. We can take questions after that. Okay, please be online.
Yeah, so if you have any doubts or questions, you can please ask now. Yeah, can you hear me, all of you? Hello? Do you have any questions? कुछ कौन है
गुड मॉर्निंग सर
या गुड मॉर्निंग
सर दिस इज अमृता
ओके हेलो गुड मॉर्निंग अमृता टेल मी
सर यू हैव टोल्ड दैट स्ट्रक्चरलिस्ट और डेरिडा सो सर प्लीज डिफाइन मोर
Okay, see, there is actually an entire, what we have done in today's class is basically an overview of what we are going to do in the rest of the class, rest of the course, I mean. So, this is the first of 8 classes on literary theory and criticism. So, a lot more, I think this comes in the last class of the unit, more on Derrida and structuralism. But then, in very basic terms, structuralism was a movement, a philosophical movement, which began in the West, which began in linguistics, and then in anthropology, and then in literature also we used it. So structuralism, basically, the whole world is, can be studied in terms of structures. Okay, so in sociology, for example, all social institutions like marriage, kinship, they are read as structures. So here also the text has many structures. reading a text in terms of structures. That is one thing which comes to mind. And the second thing is, a binaristic thinking. You know, you must remember that Western philosophical tradition, thinks it operates in terms of twos. So it is like this. It's called binaristic thinking. You know, in computers also you have zero and one, those notations. So what is binaristic thinking? You know, looking at the world in terms of twos, the good, bad, man, woman, black, white. Okay, so that is binaristic kind of thinking, and that is what Derrida. One of the things that Derrida is trying to explain, but I'm being very simplistic here right now. There's a lot more to it, but if it comes to that, I'm sure I can tell you more about structuralism and Derrida. Okay, but good that you have asked this question. If you can read that particular unit once again, you can get some more insights, and we can have further discussion on it in the relevant class.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Yeah, you're welcome. Yeah, anyone? Any other questions?
Sir, another question I have.
Yeah.
Sir, you have discussed the fourth unit. The portion for a layman, criticism serves as improvement of poem or guide the poet to improve the poem.
Yeah.
And third point, audience oriented interpret or correct critics, that is servicing as a bridge between
serving,
whom
serving as a bridge
yes serving as a bridge between whom
between the poet and the reader.
Okay sir, that's my question. Thank you, sir.
Where are you from?
That Bhubaneswar.
Okay. Any other questions? Next class, please read the relevant unit so that you have more doubts to ask, and you can ask questions in between also. But any general questions or questions pertaining to the first unit, you can ask. Mr. Ganguly, you have been listening throughout the unit with lot of attention. Are you from Bhubaneswar? I can't hear you, Mr. Ganguly. Hello. Yeah. Oh, you're from Sambalpur, huh? This was my first class online. It's a new experience. Hello, any questions? Any further questions? Where is the comment section? Comments?
You can ask him to write in case in that case.
I asked him, he's not responding.
Okay. He just left a comment.
You can write your questions also.
Could you please give us your WhatsApp number so that we can end later stage?
Hello. Good afternoon. How are you guys at home, sir? मैं नहीं अपने नाम देखा हूँ जी पहली बार देखो जी हाँ हम वहाँ से कॉपी आई थी सेटा ये माने ये वीक वितरे ये कर रहे हैं पे से प्रोसेस कॉल जोन प्रोसेस माने से ऐसे जितने भी सेंटर को प्रॉब्लम था सब सेंटर से कॉलोशन देखा सही और ये तो बहुत बड़ी अभी आती है टाइम पर वाला टाइम जी भी ऐसा तो मैं यू नो मुझको मैं सब मुझे अभी भी आसीन आने की हो चुकी
Very well. You're
knocking.
Yeah, we were calling.
Yeah, want to talk? Hello. Hello. I'm on a side of the chance.
सर नमस्कार हाँ भल अच्छे गोटे क्लास गोटे नी सर कन्फरेन्स अलरेडी एम जी फाइव बरगढ़ रे पंचायत कॉलेज रे ओ